We're going to talk about the curvature of a curve. The curvature of a curve at a point. What do you think that is? So let's say you have a curve in space. So we already know, let's say that the direction of increasing t, so we know that the tangent vectors will go like this, right? Just like in calculus 1, we're interested in the rate of change, maybe, of, right? What do you think curvature measures? I'm tired. Well, see here how it curves a lot. So if you're driving, what do you have to be very careful to do when you're driving along a steep curve? You have to pay attention, maybe you need to slow down, right? But when it's kind of pretty flat like this, it's okay to speed up, right? And those are the things we're going to learn, like what that curvature is and how that will help us decide whether to slow down or to speed up, okay? So you're going to do roads, make roads later on, okay? That's, maybe you need to know how to do this, okay? Alright, now, I don't think we have time today to really go deeply into this, but let's go through the mechanics first of how we are going to do this. For this kind of analysis, we need these two unit vectors. And maybe I'll explain next meeting why we need this, okay? Unit tangent vector, which we denote by t of t. And it's defined as r prime of t over the magnitude of r prime of t. So does the name make sense? Well, we already said that the tangent, the r prime is tangent to the curve, right? At the point?
Yes.
We just wanted to make length 1, right? Unit, so magnitude 1. The other one that we will use for this discussion is what we call the unit normal vector, which we denote by n of t. And what is that unit normal vector? It's defined as the derivative of the unit tangent vector. But if you differentiate the unit tangent vector, you think you're guaranteed that the derivative will be magnitude 1?
No.
Maybe not, right? So to make sure that it's 1, we have to divide by the magnitude of the t prime. Okay? So for today, I think I'll be happy if we can just go through the motion of this. And like before, let's try to draw a picture of what's happening to this unit tangent vector and unit normal vector. So the exercise number 4, you're given r of t is equal to 4 plus cosine ti minus negative 3 minus sine tj. We are asked to find the tangent and normal vectors there, those unit tangent and unit normal vectors, at the point where t is pi over 6. So let's just see if we can even do this. Okay? Ready?
4 plus cosine t?
Yes.
I think it is, if I copied it right. It's 4 plus cosine t, I, minus negative 3 minus sine tj. Again, those of you who don't like that notation, what can we do here? We can write it as what? 4 plus cos t for the I, and for the j is what? It's not negative.
It's not negative.
Is it not negative? Oh, yeah, yeah. It's okay. So that's okay now, right? And then this will be negative 3 plus sine t. Did I do it right?
Wait, so it's negative 3 plus sine t?
No, I think it's positive 3.
It's positive.
Mm-hmm. Positive 3 minus.
Positive 3 minus sine t. I copied too many things. Okay. So, let's start. How do we form the unit tangent vector? What do we need to do?
Take the derivative of r.
We need to get the derivative of r. Either way, which one do you want to do? What's the derivative of 4 plus cosine t with respect to t?
Negative
sine t. Those of you who like the I will do that. Those who don't will do this. Okay. All right. What about the second component? It's going to be what? Is it plus, right? Plus cos t j. Okay. So that's your r prime of t. What do we need to get? When we look at the formula for the unit tangent vector, we need the magnitude of r prime of t. But the magnitude of r prime of t is what?
1.
It's square root of sine squared t plus cosine squared t, which is 1, right? So therefore, the good news about this is that the unit tangent vector is really the same as what?
The derivative.
The derivative vector, right? In this example, okay? Because you didn't have to divide by this, this is 1. So this is, let me just copy it, it's negative sine ti plus cosine tj.
Real cotangent,
correct? Okay. Yeah, I know, I do that. Cos and t will become cotangent. Okay. Where are we now? Now we need n of t. But to get n of t, we need what? The derivative of t, right? What is the derivative of t? The derivative of t is negative cos t I minus sine t j. All right? Again, I leave it up to you. If you like the pointy bracket notation, you can do it that way. Okay? And again, the good news about this is what? Why am I excited about this? If I get the t prime of t, the magnitude of that, it's also going to be 1. So therefore, the unit normal vector that I'm looking for, which is defined to be the scalar multiple of the derivative of the tangent vector, is just really going to be the derivative of the tangent vector, right? Okay, which is this. And of course, as usual, you want to see where these guys are, right? What's happening to them. Let's try. First of all, I just did all these in general. The instruction is, let's compute these for pi over 6. T equals pi over 6. So what's T of pi over 6? T of pi over 6 is negative sine pi over 6 I plus cosine pi over 6 j. So how much is that? That's going to be negative half I, right? Plus rad 3 over 2 j. Is that correct? Did I do it right?
Yes.
Yeah. Try to see if, yeah, I'm okay. N of pi over 6 will be what? Here, right? Negative cos pi over 6i minus sine pi over 6j. So that's going to be what? Negative half I minus rad 3 over 2j. Okay. Did I do it right?
No.
Or did I? Oh no! I'm tired. I'm sleepy. Cos I did it. I did it right here. Negative rad 3 over 2 I half, right? Yeah. I was just trying to see if anybody's listening. Okay. So you're still with me. Well, I think the instruction is let's look at this on the graph. So if we are going to look for this on the graph, we might as well get what also? Well, if we're going to graph this, where are we going to graph this n of pi over 6 and t of pi over 6? At some point on the graph, right? So maybe we might as well look at what?
On the graph,
the r at pi, the position vector at pi over 6, correct? So why don't we put that here? Let's see where we are going to graph these guys. R of pi over 6 is going to be, what is it? 4 plus cos pi over 6 I minus 3 minus sine pi over 6 j. And how much is that? That's going to be 4 plus rad 3 over 2, right? I minus what? 3 minus a half j. So here maybe we need, like, this is around 1.7 divided by 2, so that's around 0.8. Is it okay? So let's just say 4.8i minus, is this 2.5? 2.5j. Whoa, okay. So this is the xy plane, right? Do you guys know how to graph this curve? Well, let's look at the x coordinate. The x is what? Is 4 plus cos t, right? And the y is, be careful, what's the y? It is negative 3 plus sine t. And you know how to do this when you have cos and sine, what do you do? You can isolate the cosine, you can isolate sine. Why do we like to do that? Because then we know cosine squared t plus sine squared t is equal to 1, right? So we know that x minus 4 squared plus y plus 3 quantity squared is equal to 1. So we say, I know the shape of the curve at least, right? What is the shape of the curve? It's a circle, center where? At 4, negative 3, and what's the radius of the circle? 1. Okay, so you suffer. Okay. 4, negative 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is your center, 4, negative 3, radius is 1. Everybody can graph a circle, right? At least we know that's the shape of the curve, right? Do we know the orientation? Do we care?
We're going to find out.
We can find out later. Can we just do that later? Okay. Where is the point that I'm looking for?
4.8
and negative 2.5. Is that around here?
Yeah.
Okay. Alright, so this is my P of pi over 6, okay? In other words, the R of pi over 6 really goes like that, correct? Okay, okay. Alright, help me, then what else do I need to graph? I need to graph T of pi over 6. From there, I count negative half to the left, correct? Half to the left, not negative, half to the left. Half to the left and 1.7 divided by 2, around 0.8 up, correct? So where is that? Half to the left and about 0.8 up is around there?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, why not? Okay. So that is your T of pi over 6. Did I do it a little? It's okay, right? You kind of see what's happening? Half to the left and up 0.8, not 1. How about the n of pi over 6? N of pi over 6 goes like 0.8 to the left, right?
Yeah.
And half down. So 0.8 to the left and half down. Is it okay to do it like that? Right? Okay, so that's your n of pi over 6. I know you're getting tired, but can you take a guess what the relationship is between t and n? They are perpendicular. Why? Can we explain why?
Because n is called normal, and if something is normal, then it's
because of the name normal, right? In calculus 1, when you said normal, it's perpendicular. Can we argue using our vector methods, vector analysis? Oh, and actually it's something that we proved before in the beginning of the class.
Something rotating will have the same thing.
And also notice here that t of pi over 6, which is the derivative of the r, is pointing that way. So can we take a guess now about the behavior of the curve? What is the orientation of the curve, you think? It looks like maybe you're going that way, right? Okay. Very good. Okay. Wait. So we know that the t in general, the t of t is perpendicular to the n of t. And I know Ethan has a very nice reason because anything normal is perpendicular, right? But that's actually like what's the term for that? It's called normal because it's perpendicular. Can you argue vector methods why it's perpendicular? What is the relationship of n to t? It came from the derivative, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's a scalar multiple of the derivative, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. What is the magnitude of t of t?
1.
It's 1. What is 1? It's a constant, right? Remember beginning of the class, long time ago, 2.5 hours ago, we said, if the magnitude of this is a constant, then this vector and its derivative must be?
0.
Must be?
Perpendicular.
Remember that? That's the very first theorem we proved at the beginning. This is a constant. Therefore, that means to say that t of t dotted with t prime of t has to be 0, and therefore they are perpendicular because n of t really is a scalar multiple of the t prime. Okay? So that's the behavior in general. And that's the kind of behavior we want for a curvature because, and we'll explain this later how this is related to acceleration and stuff.